Lord, we give thanks. For behold, what manner of love the Father's given us. For behold, what manner of love. For behold, what manner of love. For behold, what manner of love the Father's given us.
The Father's
Father's given us. Behold what manner of love. Oh, behold what manner of love. Behold what manner of love. The Father's given us. Behold what manner of love. Behold what manner of love. Behold what manner of love the Father's given us. Behold what manner of love. Behold what manner of love. Behold what manner of love the Father's given. The deepest, deepest love. The deepest kind of love. The deepest kind of fellowship and communion of oneness with Him. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. Just sing this with us about the love. It's so deep, it goes beyond any comprehension. It's so wide, nothing can stop the limits of where it can reach. Nothing too far, no one too far that the love of God cannot come and invade and call and fill. Oh, it's so great, it goes beyond. It goes beyond anything we could ever imagine. It goes beyond all time. It goes beyond all. The love of God, how rich, how pure, how measureless and strong. So strong that it grabbed you and me. It grabbed you and me. From what we could think of as the future. To bring Him to Himself. That past. That God reached down and grabbed us with His love. And He set His love and affection on us. He set His love and affection on us. And how beautiful it is. So sing this with us. Oh, how deep, how deep, how deep this love. Wide, oh, wide, oh, wide this love. How great, how great, how great this love of God. Same thing, guys, words. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great. great, so great, so great, this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep, this love. So wide, so wide, so wide, this love. So great, so great, so great, this love of God. Oh, so deep, so deep, so deep, this love. So wide, so wide, so wide, this love. So great, so great, so great, this love of God. Oh, so deep, so deep, so deep is love. So wide, so wide, so wide is love. So great, so great, so great, this love of God. Forever will I sing of your love. Forever will I sing of your love, oh God. Forever will I sing of this great love. Forever will I sing of your love. Forever will I sing of all you've done. Forever will I sing of this great love. Forever will I sing this love. Forever will I sing of what you've done. Forever will I sing of this great love. So deep, so deep, so deep.
Pour in and overwhelm.
filled right now. Being filled, be 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 filled right now. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. So deep, so deep, so deep this love. So wide, so wide, so wide this love. So great, so great, so great this love of God. When your goodness endures forever, your goodness endures forever, and your mercies endure forever.
Yes, your goodness endures forever.
target of your affection. Oh, you shed your love on me. You shed your love on me. Oh, you shed your love. Oh, you fix your gaze on me, Lord, beautiful. Beautiful Lord, beautiful Lord.
Wonderful God. Oh, what a wonderful God. Oh, Jesus. What a wonderful God. Ooh, just praise Jesus. Just praise Jesus from your heart. Oh, what a wonderful God. Just tell the Lord how wonderful He is. Oh, what a wonderful God. Oh, what a wonderful and beautiful and majestic and glorious God that we serve. Oh, what a wonderful, what a wonderful, what a wonderful God. Oh, let all the saints declare His wonders. Let all the saints declare His works and His blessings and His benefits. Oh, what a wonderful, what a wonderful, what a wonderful God. Ushadabasileti. Oh, what a wonderful, what a wonderful God. Oh, oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. What a wonderful God. What a wonderful God. We adore you, Jesus. Father, I ask you to come and fill this place. To come and grab a hold of every spirit and every heart and every mind in this place, oh God. Father, in your mercy and in your grace, come intervene on behalf of your people. Father, that you captivate all of our affections, that you captivate all of our desires, that you captivate all of our emotions, Lord Jesus. Father, that today we bring to you our best offering. Father, that today we bring our best sacrifice before you. Father, we bring all of our hearts. All of our hearts, and we put it on the altar to you. Father, anything that doesn't belong, oh God, we ask that you burn it up. You make it manifest itself. You make it expose itself so that we be tried in the fire and that it be pure gold and pure silver and pure jewels that are laid out before you in Jesus' name. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Shadabason. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You guys are good. The atmosphere just is, it's so, we've got the anointing in the house. We've got musicians that carry the anointing. I mean, you got to be Jezebel rebellious to not hook up with that, to not feel that spirit of prophecy, that spirit of the knowledge of God, the mercies of God, the love of God. I mean, it's almost more than you can handle when you interact with God, when you engage with God. There's nothing dead about our living God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Whew. So I gotta have the music stop. We gotta make a shift. Gotta make a shift for the needs of the people here. We got a lot of needs here. You can all be seated. There you go. Move up to the front. Do it quick. If you're youth. Thank you, Jesus. We can have some youth come up to the front. I need some seats filled. Give me my Calebs, my Annikas, my Lindsays, my Dominiques. Fill up these rows. I don't know. People that sit in the back, there's a reason they sit in the back. We won't go into that this morning. That's not what the message is about. The message this morning, I believe, is a gentle breeze. And we'll just see what the Holy Spirit leads and does in Jesus' name. I really want to share on living more than the eternal life, but living for the abundant life. Whew, thank you, Jesus. As believers, we're called to more than salvation. But yet many of us, we live as the thief on the cross. We call out the name of Jesus, we're instantaneously saved, and we end there. We really don't move forward. So I want to share some things that get in the way of you moving forward in the abundant life. Whew, thank you, Jesus. God said he wanted us to grow up in the fullness. The fullness, the full stature, the full measure of Jesus Christ. You hear me now? So I can't find anything in the Bible right now. Thank you, Jesus. So many believers, so many us. I'm talking to us today. I'm not talking to people on YouTube. So please don't excuse yourself from this message. Please don't in any way justify yourself from this message, because each person in this place, including myself, this message is for. Each person in this place has areas that needs adjustments, that needs fixing, that needs the cross to come be made alive to them. So do not excuse yourself from this message. I don't care if you're a leader, a saint, a sinner, or we don't know what you are. Don't excuse yourself. We're meant to live as supernatural people who possess the Son of God. When that becomes a reality, everything about your life changes. I'm eventually going to find it. Here we are. I want you to turn to Luke 8. It's crazy to think that it's possible to be saved, but never truly tapping into the benefits of God. Never truly tapping into the blessings that God has for us. God wants us to be productive in his kingdom. He wants us to live a life in his kingdom. He didn't come to just save us and then we just mosey on about with ourselves and carry on, keep calm and carry on. And then one day we pass from this life into the next and we're in heaven and we're at the judgment seat of God and it's like, yeah, I got saved. That's great. Praise God that you made it to that side of the line. But if you had time to do more for God, if you had time to take hold of the life of Jesus, if you had time to take hold of the rewards, the blessings that God has for you, the works that God has for you, on that day, and you barely made it in to be saved. Praise God you got saved. Praise God you made it in that line. But you'll have great sorrow on that moment when you look at your life and you said, God shows it all before you and you look at all the time that you had to fulfill the call of God on your life, all that God intended, all the blessings that you could have lived in, all the things that you could have done in the kingdom of God. There'll be great sorrow for you. Praise God you'll make it into eternity if you did, but that's a risk. Because how can God say, well done, my good and faithful servant, when you really didn't do a job well done? Or you really weren't that faithful? I mean, my God, we're barely faithful with coming into the house of God. And it's even more exposed and manifest when pastor's gone because clearly you don't honor God. Now I'm not speaking to the people here just because they're not here. But there's people in this place. You can't even be faithful to seeking first the kingdom of God, just on the basic elementary level of honoring the house of God. Saying, pastor's out of town, and it is up to me to be a bridge, to hold the gap, to be a watch for my brothers and sisters, to make sure that there's no open door, there's no crack to Satan to take anybody out, that we are here to be upholding the house. That's each one's responsibility to uphold your temple, the temple of God in your body, and to uphold the temple of God here in the church, the local church, the body. We cannot neglect this greatest salvation and all the things that this greatest salvation demands and requires of us. So that has to do with my message, but that wasn't where we were going. Praise the Lord, Jesus. I mean, I'm just going to continue on this for just a little bit. We as the children of God, the sons of God, we that have been saved, genuinely saved, we cannot be living from problems to problems. And so much of the church, they live from problem to problem to problem. We're supposed to be living from soul to soul to soul. From blessing to blessing to blessing. To honor to honor to honor. To glory to glory to glory. Come on, I'm talking about the rewards here. The rewards when you go up to that judgment seat of God. And he's saying, okay, let's go ahead and throw your life on the barbecue pit and see what's left. Well, sometimes I honored my parents. Well, sometimes I served in the church when a lot of people were doing it and it was fun and it worked out and it was convenient with my schedule. I didn't have to change work. I didn't have to wake up early on my Saturday. The ulterior motives that are there, I tell you right now, that's not faithful, and that will be burned up as wood, stubble, and hay. But when the motives are right, the intentions are right, it doesn't matter if nobody else is doing it. Come hell or high water, you're going to be there to do it. You feel that weight of the ministry, the weight of the call, the weight of the cross on your shoulder. That's not going to be wood, stubble, and hay. That's going to be a reward. Whether that's honor or glory and all the different dimensions that's laid out in Romans. When you're saved, your works are important. It's not by works that we're saved, but when we're by the grace of God, we're saved. And when we're saved, those works, they count. When the motives are right, when the heart is right to do it, when it's after seeking first the kingdom of God because you're so in love with Jesus, you're so compelled. Can you hear me now? Thank you, Jesus. So let's go to Luke 8. I think I'm going to start in about verse 4 to break in. And this is one of the most, I feel like one of the most pillar parables that Jesus spoke. A pillar parable in the Bible. And really, if you cannot get this, you really can't get any of the other parables. If you can't understand this, if you can't hear this, just know. Your father's the devil, and that's why you cannot understand. That's why you cannot hear. That's why you refuse to do it. So we'll recognize that now. That way we can get you fixed. We can get you cleaned up. Say, okay, I want to understand this. And more than understand this, I want to believe this. And if we believe it, then we're doing it. Because don't tell me you believe something that you're not doing. Everything you're doing is a measure of what you believe. You can talk about how you believe in fairies and how you believe in this, that, and the other thing. But unless you're walking that fairy life out, whatever it is, we all think you're crazy. And none of us believe you. So not to be crude to compare that to Jesus, so understand me where I'm going with this and making my point. But you can say all you want of what you believe in Jesus. But if you're not willing to walk it out and to activate it, to engage in doing it, the world thinks you're crazy. And unfortunately, the church hasn't confronted you and let you know you're religious. You're dead. It's dead. It's dead works. It's dead acts. It's dead words. So we're going to break into Luke 8, verse 4. And a great crowd coming together, and the ones in each city coming to him, he spoke through a parable. The one sowing went out to sow his seed. We've all heard this parable, I hope, many, many, many times. But we failed to grab a hold of some things here. And in his sowing, some indeed fell beside the way and was trampled, and the birds of heaven ate it up. And the other fell on the rock, and growing, it dried up because of not having moisture. Another fell in the middle of thorn bushes, and growing up with it, the thorn bushes choked it. And other fell on good earth, and growing, it produced fruit 100-fold, saying these things, he cried out, the one having ears to hear, let him hear. Now we see that the seed is the word of God. Does that make sense to everybody? I'm a youth pastor. I like interaction. I like people responding. It helps me know that when you're kids and you're going through all your different changes, you fall asleep a lot. I mean, I remember fourth period of high school, without fail, I was sound asleep. And right as the bell would ring, it was like clockwork. I would wake up right before the bell. So I like responses. I like to make sure nobody's sleeping in the house. Nobody should be terrified, because we have the remedy. We have the cure for you today. So everything coming out, whether it be intense, harsh, uncomfortable, stabbing, poking, jabbing, whatever, it should be a blessing, because there's change for you here this morning. Now, if you start feeling that discomfort and you don't want to change, you're going to fight what's being said and you don't agree, that's the doorway. I just want to make that clear for everybody, okay? Because we want to have a move of God. We want to grow on to mature. We don't want to be stuck. I'm looking for a people that want to be more than just saved and make it for eternity, make it into heaven by the skin of their teeth, and call that, well done, my good and faithful servant. So if you're just wanting to barely make it in, this meeting isn't for you. You can go ahead and excuse yourself, because I won't have anything to say that will benefit you whatsoever. So we look, the seed is the word. The word is, it's always good. What we have to understand is the problem is with us. The problem is with how we mix it. Are we mixing it with faith, or are we mixing it with our own ideas, our own opinions, our own concepts of how we think it should work out? How we think we can accomplish what the word is saying by our might and our power and our strength, rather than by the Holy Ghost. So we can imagine, before you're saved, the field is just a junkyard. Okay? I like pictures. I like to visualize things. I'll tell the kids, you know, I want you to really put yourself in this situation. Get, you know, just think of all the, how would you really react if you were in this situation? We all make fun of Thomas, but Thomas would be the greatest believer in majority of the houses here in the church. We all act like, oh, I don't want to be with Thomas. I don't want to see Thomas. I don't want to hang out in that crowd. It's like, you don't have nothing on Thomas compared to how we live. Come on, you know? And so I really like to make people really visualize themselves of, how would you actually react? How would you actually respond in these kinds of situations? We discredit Peter, and we discredit these different ones, when it's like, come on. You wouldn't even been on the disciples' chain. You would have been the follower that, as soon as God demanded some kind of authority, some kind of maturity, said, see ya, I'm not getting my handouts anymore. Looks like he's not feeding me anymore. Looks like he's not rubbing my pew anymore. And you're out. Come on. Because if you're not feeling uncomfortable with the sacrifices that you're making for the cross, then don't tell me that you're one of the disciples. I'm here for a reality check this morning. I want to encourage you. I want to seed you. But I also want to make you extremely uncomfortable with yourself. Extremely uncomfortable saying, I got some major adjustments. I've been staring at the worldly church too long, defining of how I can live my life, how I can serve in the church. I've been looking around me instead of looking at Jesus. So we're imagining a field. It's full of junk. It's full of just worthlessness. It's disgusting. Nobody would even take the yard if it was free. It's just terrible. It's full of hurt. It's full of offense. It's full of pain. It's full of abuse. It's full of biohazards of all sorts. That's our life before we were saved. I don't care if you grew up in church your whole life. That's your life before you're saved. Before you truly meet the Master. And Jesus comes in with the bulldozer of the blood, bulldozer of the cross, just cleans it up, makes it look beautiful, a beautiful field. But that field is empty, okay? You see where I'm going with this? The field's been cleaned out. The field's been prepared. But now it's empty. What are you going to do with your salvation? What are you going to do in the field that God has given you? Are you going to leave it as is, we're all good, and hope that you don't get deceived and fall into something else? Because when the house is clean, there's a great opportunity for even worse to come in if you're not living a life for the kingdom of God. And if we had the wisest, greatest man, Solomon, not be exempt from deception, who on earth are you to think that we could just neglect our salvation, that we could just neglect our field? You need to be filling yourself with the seed of the word, because Satan has a strategy for each person to hinder them from believing, to hinder them from producing. And so I really want to pinpoint some things that Satan does to distract us, to hinder us from producing, from really truly being productive in the kingdom of God. And I want to ask too, are there those here that you've got a field, you've done things in God, but now you're just at this place in your life where you're a frustrated field. You don't understand why now there's really not producing good fruit. You're saying, why am I stuck? Why am I not moving on? Why am I not carrying on for these greater works, these greater encounters, these greater blessings? You're a frustrated field. God, you used me in the past. What's going on now? What's happening now? So I also want to talk to people. If you've got a frustrated field and you don't understand, why are you on hold, so to speak? So if you look in verse 10, I'm going to keep just kind of breaking this down. So we look at verse 10. And he said to you, it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to rest in parables, that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. Sorry, Siri's talking to me. I don't know how to turn her off. She's demonic. And this is the parable. The seed is the word of God. And the ones by the roadside are the ones who hear, and the devil comes up and takes away the word from their heart, lest believing they may be saved. So I'm going to talk about three enemies to living in the kingdom of God. We just named the first one. So we look, there's these footpaths, the seed, it was thrown on the footpaths, depending on your translation for what it says, but it all means the same. The footpaths of your thinking. Do we have any science anatomy nerds? Anybody looked at a brain? Cool. So some of you will understand. I think majority of people, you've seen a picture of a brain, right? Can I get a show of hands, some response? We've seen a brain. Cool, little picture. So I like to look at these footpaths as brain grooves. You know what I'm saying? Those brain grooves, those, okay, good. And those brain grooves are the footpaths of the way that you think. Now, when you go to school, you learn, you know, 2 + 2 = 4, 4 + 4 = 8. You know, that has been a very solid footpath in your mind, so to speak, and nobody can convince you differently. I mean, if I'm going to tell you that the sky is pink, and every day the sky is pink, you're going to look at me like, oh, Lord Jesus, help. And hopefully if you're a person of faith, you're going to turn to the Holy Ghost and start praying for healing. Because we're all going to be very clearly saying, look at, the sky is clearly blue. Okay, so these are grooves. These are ways of thinking that we have. They're very sure footpaths in our mind. The problem is when we establish thinking that's wrong. And we make that solid grooves in our brain, solid footpaths against the word. That happens with religion. It happens with false doctrines. It happens with just being too much in the world and allowing ungodly counsel in our lives instead of going to the word of God and making the word of God our reality. And the more you think the certain way, the deeper those grooves are in the brain. The deeper those footpaths are against the seed, against the word of God. And then and in those kinds of ways, the seed, the word of God, they can't penetrate. Because it's not how you've been taught. It's not the way you think. You disagree. You have your own opinion. You have your own experience. Because we're such a celebrity society where we are the shiznits. We think higher than each other. We think smarter than each other. We've got the answers more than each other. Rather than really honoring and taking hold and seeing by the eyes of the Spirit the anointing. The anointing that's in that person's life, because all of heaven, when the anointing is in your life and you've been placed in a place of authority, in a place of leadership, all of heaven's going to back up those words. All of heaven's going to be behind what's being said. And if there's some things that are wrong, you know, it's not sin. It's just not very clear. You just disagree, you know, because you got another opinion. I tell you what, God's going to be on the side of the person he placed in authority, and you'll get a blessing when you obey, or you can go ahead and get your own censor and let God judge between the man in authority's word and your word. I didn't get an amen on that one. Nobody likes that one. Whenever people get rough with me, I just go ahead and bring that out. You know what? I'll take my judgment now. You go get your censor. Let the Lord judge between your word and mine. Because I'm not going to play games. And if I'm wrong, come on, God, show me, expose me, manifest it in Jesus' name. And typically people that come to fight against the anointing authority, they don't do that. Because they're staunch on their word. They're staunch on their fist. They're staunch on their strength. Now, how much of that goes on in your own life where you're not willing to just allow God to just take the cross in your brain, in your footpaths, in your mind, and just plow it all up. Plow up everything you know. I mean, there's people I meet, they've grown up in church. Their mama did this, their daddy did this, blah, 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 blah. All this stuff, you know, that makes you feel really important and special. And I'm just like, erase the chalkboard. Completely erase everything that you've been taught. And let's go to the Word and start all over. Because, and us as believers that have that sit in the church and we don't do what the Word demands us to do, you better make sure that you keep your heart in that place of God. Oh God, come plow up these footpaths so that I don't become hardened to the Word, that I don't become a dead religious person that can just excuse it and just be like, okay, I'll do that later, or that's not for me, that's for somebody else, and you become hardened. Eventually your spirit becomes seared, and you become in such a reprobate state that there's nothing about the anointing that can truly break you, that can truly touch you. Because my God's an emotional God. He's a deep God. He's an intense, loving God that demonstrates such passion, such emotion, such kindness, such mercy, such authority. And we all walk around in the church like a bunch of Germans. I get to say that because me and my husband, we got a good amount of German in us. So well, I say, don't let the German come out. It's time to get emotional with God. It's time to take on the culture of heaven and stop living our lives like numb. I mean, there's a reason why everybody's fascinated with zombies right now, because the church looks like a bunch of medicated zombies. We're just coming, let out a few grunts here and there to the Lord, supposedly. And we continue on with our life and doing our thing, and it's just what's normal, and we look like we're all medicated. Until you get to the football game, or you get to something you really enjoy, your cooking class, or I don't know what it is. I don't know what floats your boat and gets you excited and tickles your stomach, but if there's anything in your life that makes you more emotional than the emotions that you bring into the house of God, my God, you're not seeking first the kingdom of God. My God, your affections are not in the kingdom of God. And I don't have to go into what Jesus says about that if you're not seeking first the kingdom of God. I think we have a good enough grasp here. So I just want to bring some soberness. You say, well, my emotions are steady all the time. Nothing really excites me. Nothing really gets me tickled. Nothing, you know, I'm very stable. Yeah, I fell under that for I think when I was about 12 or 13, thought that was a good path to go on. Just stay consistent, stable, live by principle, not emotion. Because we do, we live by principle, not emotion. But I'm talking about emotions towards God, towards the things of heaven, okay? And you're dead. I mean, you're dead. There's nothing producing life in you. There's a reason why people aren't getting touched, changed, delivered, set free. There's a reason why you can't even get yourself touched, saved, delivered, set free. Because you're too stuck in consistency and never allowing any kind of emotion, life. So much joy, there's so much peace, there's so much love, there's so much authority in the Spirit of God. So some of the things, ways that Satan comes very subtly is through media, through our friends, through our family, etc. Apply to your life, fit in what I mean, what I'm talking about, okay? So if I miss something, you know, just go ahead and insert it there. If you keep, just a very simple example. If you keep watching movies, you know, there's people I grew up with, and a lot of kids that I grew up with, they don't go to this church anymore, and that really burdened me, hit my heart hard, and why I stepped into youth ministry, because I said, Lord, I don't ever want to lose another kid. I don't ever want to lose another person that's grown up in this house. So I'm going to demand change. I'm going to demand exposing and transparency. I'm going to demand honesty. And if they can't get right with that kind of demand, well, then they're just going to get in the way of the things of God anyways. And so that was really where my heart was. I don't ever want to lose another kid. So people in my generation, there's different ones. They really didn't have a lot of censorship on the things that they could watch or the people that they could hang out with or the things that they could do. And yeah, when you're a kid, you're like, oh, my parents are so strict. It's such a bummer. It's such a blessing that your parents are in your life, in your space, and allowing you to understand that God rules with a rod, with a strict rod, and you got to learn how to understand obedience and sacrifice now. So praise God that they're not just letting you run free, wild, and wherever you want to do your thing. So one of the things was growing up, and I knew some of my friends, they could watch, you know, certain movies, and praise the Lord, my dad, he just, you're not going to watch that love stuff. You know, the Westerns were okay, and some of that was about the height of the love stories we were allowed to participate in. But some of my friends, they would watch movies, and I'm picking on movies right now, and where sex is okay before marriage, because it doesn't show anything on the movie, you know, it doesn't show anything, you know, it's still got a rating that's okay, you know, but there's still that seed that says sex is okay before marriage. That's planted there. And that becomes a footpath. And almost each one of those friends that were able to do that, that were in this church, they're not here anymore. And most of them participated with that. Because it's a seed that creates a footpath, a hardened footpath, a way of thinking. And then the word is rejected of what the word says about the holiness of marriage, the sacredness of marriage. We get all too scared to talk about the holiness of marriage, the sacredness of marriage. We got too much of that old-fashioned taboo where you just don't talk about it, you know? We got to talk about the holy things of God. Make sure it's very clear with our kids, with each other. Because when we're keeping things exposed, when we're keeping things transparent, when we're keeping the fire stoked, the enemy is like a cockroach, man. He hangs out in the dark. He hangs out in the shadows. He hangs out where things are, you know, not really clear in the gray areas. Because there's no gray areas in the Bible. So if we were exposing there, you know. Thank you, Jesus. Or the way you dress. You look at the world for the way that you dress. That's creating its seeds in your mind. Or listening to the counsel of people. It's crazy because this happens all the time. It's like people go to the goats for counsel rather than going to the sheep. Who gave them the wisdom? Like what put them on the pedestal for why their counsel's good? Usually because it's what you want to hear. I don't know. I don't know why people do what they do. I don't want to know. And you go to ungodly counsel, or you just go to people that just have fleshly advice. They don't live by the Spirit. They don't speak by the Spirit. They don't say, you know what? Let's go to the Word of God. Let's find the answers in the Word of God. Let's ask the Holy Spirit right now of what He has to say for the situation or the circumstance or the issue that you are in. Rather, people give just flesh, stinky flesh. Or ungodly counsel. I don't know what's worse. It keeps both in a ditch. And understanding that we have to go to the Word, because the seed of truth, what God says about marriage, about counsel, about wisdom, about the way that we're to be living our lives, if you've allowed those footpaths to be in your life and you're not willing to be exposed to allow the cross to plow it up, you're going to reject the truth and go with your opinion, someone else's opinion, someone's experience, somebody's religion. I hate religion. I mean, there's things I say, and if you got religion in you, man, it makes you uncomfortable and you don't like it. Because I have a passionate, vehement flame towards religion, and I'm always asking God, God, let there be no religion in my life. If there's religion in my life, expose it, manifest it, take it out. Whatever you have to do, if I've got to be crippled, sick, dead, and dumb to get my attention, do it now, God, because I don't want religion in my life. I grew up mad at the church because of religion. Satan almost took out my life because of religion. I got sick of looking at people that weren't doing jack diddly squat in the kingdom of God. And that's the wrong way to look at it. I was young, dumb, and immature. And it was a way that Satan was able to come and access into my heart, and it almost took me out. Until finally one day I said, God, took my eyes off of everybody else. And I said, God, I just want to know you. I know that you're real. I've seen way too much to not know that you're real. But I want to know you. I want to have the life that you intended and intricately planned for me to have while you shaped me in my mother's womb. And it had to become real. I mean, it was snot, it was tears, it was crying out to God, it was getting alone with God. It was, I'm not taking another bite of food, I'm not taking another drink of water until I get something from God. You get God's attention when you get real with Him. But we just want to do this flip of a hand. Oh God, do this in my life. Make me count. Okay, honey, what are we going to eat? Okay, let's go carry on with our jobs. Oh, yeah, we'll lay our job aside when lightning strikes and a dove from heaven comes and the Holy Spirit shouts with a loud voice saying, this is what you're supposed to do. I mean, it's crazy the way that we live our lives. Rather than being sensitive for that small tug, that gentle tug that just says, that person needs to be talked to about Jesus. That person needs a miracle. You got the supply. There's a nation calling. There's a man in a tomb screaming, and you're his answer. But we're too busy with our bills and everything else. You know, it's crazy. I mean, I'm just going to say it. If you're not willing to leave your job tomorrow, I tell you, your job is a distraction in keeping you from seeking first the kingdom of God. Anything in your life, your job, your kids, whatever it is, if that's what you're saying keeps you from being pulled wherever the Holy Spirit would lead you, it's a distraction and it's out of order. Because kids, job, everything comes into line when your priorities are right. When your attention, when your heart, when all of your desires, all of your emotions are on Jesus Christ and the life of Jesus Christ, everything else will be in order. We're not even barely through, my God. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, we live in a society that says whatever feels good is right, whatever makes you happy. That's what the Lord has called you to do. It's the will of God for your life. And I'm like thinking when I hear that. And too many people talk in the bathroom because I'm in there and I'm just like. I'm just going to say it. If you're giving words in the bathroom or you're giving words in the parking lot, you got a spirit of Jezebel on you and you need to get delivered. Because words aren't for the bathroom and words aren't for the parking lot. They're for the house of God. And if you're not going to speak them in the house of God, then you're under a spirit of Jezebel and you need to be delivered. Because we don't want old Jezzy reincarnated running around the house. Same with men. Don't act like it's just a girl thing. I'm seeing more men with the spirit of Jezebel and the spirit of Delilah than I've ever seen before. I mean, they're right up with the ladies. Anyway, so we're going to continue on. You wonder why you have marriage problems. Or you wonder why things just aren't working out how they should be. You're not making enough money. You're not this, that, the other thing. You've got your eyes on the world. You're learning from the world rather than learning from heaven, rather than learning from the kingdom of God. Do we have anybody sleeping? If you're asleep, go ahead and wake up. If your neighbor sees you sleeping, go ahead and give him a tap. Maybe give him some water. So I'm going to ask you this question. I like people to take notes. There's sermons that are for notes, and there's sermons that aren't really for notes. It's just for your spirit to just grab a hold of. This is kind of more of a sermon, I feel like, that's for notes and for your spirit to grab a hold of. So if you have notes, you can take them. I feel like I'm breaking things down pretty simply. Concepts that you can really bullet point and go back and study and grab a hold of and put before the Lord and ask the Holy Spirit to come make manifest revelation in your life. So one of the questions that you can write down if you have notes is, what areas in your mind do you have that stop you from receiving, moving forward in the Word of God? I'll say it one more time. What areas in your mind do you have that stop you from receiving, moving forward in the Word of God? Don't exempt yourself this morning, because all of us have some. Because if you don't have the fullness fully manifested, nonstop, continually, these works and greater, all of heaven coming down at the sound of your voice and the everything shaking and breaking and trembling at the stomp of your foot, then my God, you've got things hindering you. And I don't see anybody that's really even close to that. So I'm sure we can start with a list here. If we were in youth, we would have a little bit of interaction. Okay, give me some feedback. What are some things that you can see right now that are getting in the way? But we won't do that with you this morning. Most of us all know what your issues are. You just don't know for whatever reason. So understanding the word, it springs alive in your life. It will bring forth fruit if you're willing to plow up those ways of thinking, those footpaths. Not just act like you're right and your religion's better than ours or whatever. I don't know. I have no religion. Oh, good. Let's see the miracles. Oh, good. Let's see the souls. Oh, good. Let's see the joy, the peace, the love fully manifested right now. Oh, it comes to me when I get in my bedroom. You shine the brightest when you're in church. So if you're going to act like you got something else going on at home, I say you got some strange fire. Because you're going to shine the brightest when you're in the body, the local church, where Jesus has manifested himself. You get impartations right here. You get deeper depths, deeper realms right here. And it carries home with you when you take it. So then you just get to live in this. You just get to flow in this. You get to just grow in this. You get to just mature in this. And then you come back to church and you get to go for another level. Said people live from touch to touch to touch to touch to touch, never producing nothing. And you're irresponsible with the touches that God gives you. And you get stuck in a response. You get stuck in emotion. You know, we've got different names for people. I try to be careful. But some, it's just religion, man. We've got butterfly man. You know, we've got corn shucker. And you can't make fun of people if you're not willing to confront them. Because you're no different. Your religion's no different. It's just as stinky. At least we got something going on. Okay, let's get this fixed, you know? So I'm not going to continue on that. So let's go to the next one, the next point. The next enemy, okay? I think we're in verse 13. And the ones on the rock are the ones who, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, who believe for a time, and in time of trial, draw back. So I want you to look at the rocks. I want you to look at it as being the shallow soil of your heart. If the devil can't get you to think wrong, keep you in a wrong mindset, those wrong footpaths, those wrong opinions, then he's going to go after the soul of your heart. He's gonna go for keeping you shallow so that the word can really never take deep root. So that when you have the emergency response or you have any kind of trial or you have any kind of circumstance or situation or problem that happens, you don't turn to the word because the word never took root. You turn to 911 or you turn to mom or you turn to, you know, whoever. Whatever's in this earth, rather than having the word of God already in you to take the victory over the situation that you're in. So you look at that soil that's rock, the word, it has no traction, it has no roots, it has no moisture. And some of those enemies, those rocks, so to speak, can be things like selfish ambition, just ambition. Desiring position or desiring status that God hasn't given you. Or it's just not, your time is just not yet. Because we understand promotion, it comes from the Lord. I mean, to stand up here and have the microphone, it's a fearful and trembling thing. But I'd never be up here if I wasn't living a life that says, I'm going out there. I'm seeking after these deeper things. I don't need a microphone to talk about Jesus. I prefer not a microphone. I love one-on-ones. To me, it's some of the most effective ministry to just go looking for one. You don't have 100 problems you're having to discern through and sort through. You can just one right there. Boom, boom, boom. I love it. It's beautiful. It's such a wonderful privilege. It's such a, not to be crude, but it's such a high. I mean, when you get punched or you get bit or you get all sorts of crazy things that happen to you, you walk away from it not even touched. Or even more so, even more beautiful, there's tears, there's a cry for repentance, and you get to lead them right then and there. And you see a genuine encounter with God come on them. And you just, I mean, your heart's just so moved in it because it's, salvation is just such an incredible gift. It's such a miracle. It's the greatest miracle. We have the greatest miracle by calling on the name of Jesus and having salvation. We act like we can't go heal the sick and raise the dead and see the crippled walk and the blind see. I mean, it's a crazy way of thinking. Those are small miracles compared to the miracle of salvation. When we have salvation, all has been given to us. All authority, all power. The Son of God comes and resides and lives on the inside. But religion has created this thing as if salvation's just this passing by thing, and we have to convince people to accept Jesus. If you have to convince that person to accept Jesus, you're going to convince them through the whole walk through God. They need to have a reality of their sins. They need to have a reality of Jesus. They need to have a reality of the cross. When I talk to people about Jesus, I get real with it. I bring the love of God, but if they've got stinky religion and all these things, oh yeah, God's given me this sickness, this disease, and this is just my calling, say, then you'll stay stuck in that for the rest of your life if you truly believe that that's what God has for you, because God really wants to give you a miracle, but some insecure liar lied to you and said that that's what God gave you. I just wanted to do miracles, so I went for the craziest things at school. I don't know what this kid had. I think it was something where you're in the wheelchair and you don't have a lot of, like, coordination. And I just went after him with the love of God. And the demon started speaking to me with multiple voices. It was wild. It's very exciting. You know you're doing something right when you get a reaction. Because Jesus always got a reaction, mad, sad, or glad. If we're not getting a reaction, then turn up the anointing. Because you're stuck in you. And I don't know why I'm sharing this story. It has nothing to do with the message. But this kid, he just started having all these demons cry out as I started just sharing something really sweet and simple about the love of Jesus. And so we went after that thing. I binded the devil. I said, devil, you shut up so this spirit can be sober and hear what I'm saying in Jesus' name. Still, quietness. Satan's voice was shut instantaneously when I just addressed the spirit. We started out with the love of God. Satan started responding. So we told devil to shut up so the man could hear the word of God and be sobered. Satan was shut up. And now I was dealing with the person. Because that's the power God's given us. He's given us the authority to completely shut up the devil. But he doesn't trespass man's will. So now we deal with the person. And this kid was full of religion. And so it was a sad thing. Next thing I know, after he rejected the word, he flew out of his wheelchair and started manifesting. And then he says, help me get up. I said, no, I'm not helping you unless you want Jesus to come invade your life. I'm not going to help you back into that wheelchair unless you want a miracle. Yes, I walked away and left him. And I stalked for a little while. And within about 20 minutes, I came back around. I said, are you still going to reject the miracle that Jesus has for you? He says, yes, I don't want it. I said, okay. I pray that in the mercy and the grace of God that you have a chance before you leave this life. People will reject. That's not your deal. So long as you bring the heat, so long as you bring the anointing, so long as you don't hold back, you know that you brought everything. You brought all the guns out, you know? Anyways, we'll continue on. Some just fun things that the Lord does in your life. When you just be you and God. And by saying be you, I mean be Jesus. When you just be Jesus in the life that he's given you. There's nothing insecure. There's nothing really scary about it. There's nothing weird about it. It's just Jesus. It's just how we're supposed to live our life. If we got to go get pumped up, blowed up, and, you know, have everybody lay hands on us before we can do anything in the kingdom of God, I mean, how far are you living in your own flesh? How far out are you from the Spirit? We're supposed to be living, walking, moving, breathing in the Spirit of God. So you need to do checkups on yourself. You need to go, okay, I'm going to start praying, Lord Jesus. How far am I away from touching heaven? How far away am I from knowing that at the sound of my voice, all of heaven is listening, all of heaven is open to hear my voice right now, to hear my prayers? How far away am I from engaging in the spiritual things? How far away am I from a song, a hymn, a spiritual song? How far away am I from prophecy? How far away am I from a word of knowledge? How far away am I from the things, the riches, the blessings of God? You got to do checks on yourselves, measure yourselves, evaluate yourself. Continually measuring, evaluating. Where am I? You think of like a thermometer. Where am I on the gauge here? Are we really far right now? You know, we get mad in my house, and Daniel is the best at it. He would just, you need to pray in the spirit right when you're in the heat of it, you know? The heat of the growing hormones of teenagehood. You need to pray in the spirit. Because you recognize, like, you want to launch out and say no, you know? But then you just manifest yourself that you're totally, like, having nothing to do with the gift of God right now. You know? And so it's just like, oh, okay. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And get back in the spirit. Okay, so back to my point. So, things that cause us to reject producing fruit, allowing the word to produce fruit, selfish ambition, desiring position that God hasn't given us, okay? We don't take time to find what God's destiny is for our lives. Instead, we go ahead and chart our own course and throw that at God and say, God bless it. Look at, I'm not saying this because I have no idea, you know, that this is all just you guys. I am a planner to the T. My plan, my course, charted out. Oh God, your will be done, but here's my plan. You know? This is the job I'm going for. This is my education path. This is who I'm going to marry. This is how many kids I'm going to have. You know, all these different things that we do. All the different things that you do. Okay? And we just tell the Lord, here it is. Here's my destiny. Bless it. God's not in that. He's constantly drawing you with tender cords of loving kindness. He's always wanting to bless you, but he's not going in your box. If you want to be serious for Jesus, you want to live in abandonment for Jesus, you truly want to take the life of Christ, you're going to say to the wind with those plans, Father, here it is. If you want me to be on the street preaching the gospel, there it is. If you want me to be on the mission field, I'll go. Whatever it is, if you want me to clean the toilets, I'll do it. And it doesn't stop at the toilets. It doesn't stop at being the water person or the plant person or the sound person. God is always calling us to promotion. They're just steps that we take. They're just steps that we show where our heart's at. How faithful can you be in the few? How faithful can you be in the small things? The things that we would deem meaningless. But when we chart our own course and say, God, you're going to bless it, there's not a whole lot he can do. We just kind of make it and hope to have some joy and peace and love in there and maybe bring a soul to church in 20 years. I mean, if we at least had each person in this place bringing one soul each 20 years, we would have grown, you know. Come on, check yourself. How many of you have even invited in this last year? How many of you got through the door? How many of you have actually got yourself through the door faithfully? Lord Jesus, the next point is entitlement. Next thing that keeps us. Well, I deserve that. Or you see somebody new coming into the church and they're growing exponentially and then they get that position or they get to start serving there. They're getting some recognition and you're like, I've been here for 15, 20 years and I haven't gotten to do that. Or somebody else has given your position, so to speak, and you're all hostile over it. Like, no, that's mine. I bind that thing. Anybody that's got any hostile territory in this place, I make sure you're not serving. When you get a heart adjustment, you can serve, man. This has nothing to do with that. It has nothing to do with this entitlement thing. It has to do with where your heart and affections are and how you're serving the Lord and where you're going with the Lord and how much are you going to give to God. You're always kind of just, you've got this thing of where I ought to be, where I should be, and you just, you never really allow God to do what he wants to do with you because you think you're supposed to already have that nicer house or already have that car, already have that job or already have that spouse or whatever it is that you think that you're already supposed to have and you're just not where you should be. And so you're so distracted with that kind of thing, that kind of entitlement. You never really allow God to do just what he wants to do in your life. Because you're not just open before God, whatever you want to do, God. Here I am, God, fully exposed, fully transparent. Here we are, God. What's the course for today? Who am I supposed to talk to today? What dimension of heaven am I going to today? Holy Spirit, how should I react to this decision? How should I respond to this decision today? Rather, you're just stuck in this mindset of, well, we should have been already here. We should have done this, that, and the other thing, you know? And you just allow your mind to be bogged down in that sense of unfulfillment. The next one is jealousy or competition or comparison. You're just stuck. You're looking around you, what other people are doing, rather than looking at Jesus. You're jealous because you're not getting the attention you feel you should deserve. Really quick, if you're on Facebook or you're texting or anything, I understand mothers, if you have unruly children, you have to watch your phones, but please don't be on Facebook in the church. Especially don't share my posts during the meeting, because then it flashes up when I have the Bible on and I think, I wanted to tomahawk someone the other day. I do carry weapons. When you've got the jealousy, you've got the comparison, you've got the competition, you're going to totally miss out what God has for you. In the most elementary, simplest forms, you're going to totally miss out on it. And some people just go with that as that, if that's okay. That's acceptable to you. You're like Eli, blind and fat and miserable. Your will be done, you know? And it's like, what? You need to be passionate. You need to put a demand. You need to put a petition before God. We can demand God and command God for the things of the Spirit, for the life of Christ Jesus, for eternal heavenly things. The rest of this stuff, don't put God in a box. He's not going in there. You get all disappointed because God didn't come through and had nothing to do with the plan of God for your life. It's like, no, over here, over here. I hope that somebody can hear me, that somebody can understand what I'm meaning. I know communication is an art, so just thank you, Holy Spirit, that you just come and you just make the word clear and sharp to every person here in Jesus' name. The next one is bitterness. Nobody wants to think they have bitterness. Nobody. I've never met anybody that goes, oh, yes, I have the anointing for bitterness. It's just always on me. I just never met anybody. I mean, you can see somebody that's just festering with bitterness, and they're like, I'm not bitter. You know? But you have to understand, bitterness will sabotage what God wants to do in your life. Bitterness is one of those chief things that keeps people stuck. More than the jealousy, more than the comparison, more than the competition, more than the selfish ambition, more than the entitlement. Bitterness is so sneaky, yet so destructive. I mean, the best way to just simply put bitterness is you're still mad. That person's name comes up or that situation comes up and you're like, I'm not mad. No big deal. And there's totally like an emotion change, you know? Or it just really fires it up and it's just like, ugh, you know, it just, if there's a freak out. And you got to evaluate what areas still make you mad that you just haven't put on the altar, that you haven't put on the cross and you truly released. You got to examine your heart, because bitterness will stop the word. And not only will it stop the word, it will poison your entire field from ever truly producing. And one of the things you have to understand is you don't have the right to ever be mad. Except against sin. You can be mad at the devil, but don't be too overwhelmed with anger towards him, or else you're just going to walk around mad all the time and forget about the joy and the peace and the love of Jesus Christ, you know? So the only thing you can be mad about is sin and Satan. But that truly is the only thing that you would have a right to be mad about. There's nothing in this life outside of that you have a right to even be mad about. It doesn't matter even if you're right in this situation. If you're right and you're mad, you're wrong. Because that's not how Jesus works. And that's not how the Holy Spirit works. So you have to understand that even if you're right in the situation and if you're mad about it, you're wrong and you're in bitterness. And some people, I mean, they want to be so right, they would rather be on the slow track in God than release it because you're right. I'm right till the day I die, you know. It's just crazy. Rather than just being humble, I mean, you've always got to take the position of look it. Doesn't matter what it is outside of the Word of God. We know nothing. We truly know nothing. So we can never, ever, ever have that right to not be humble enough to say, look it. Let's examine here. I could be wrong, you know. I probably am wrong if I've got this attitude, you know. And I mean, you ask the Lord to expose it to you because it's sneaky. I mean, I had a time in my life where I just went through a bad situation. And I thought I'd released everything and moved forward, kind of. Deep down in my heart, I knew I hadn't. That person's name would come up, and man, I'd get fired up. I wouldn't even reject it. It was like, we don't even say that, you know, like, no, we don't say that name around here. Yeah, I get fired up every time, and it really messed with my emotions, and it really messed with my heart, and it would take me some time to recuperate. I mean, it'd be like the thing where pastor says you get 5 minutes, and now you're down to 20 seconds, and I'm like, hours, and I would just go cry about it and just be like, God, I don't want this in my life. I don't want this attitude, this behavior, this emotion. It's so wrong. It's so not of you. But yet every time I think of the situation, I'm just bombarded. I'm just flooded with the hurt, the pain, the offense of it all, you know? So I turned to the Holy Spirit, and it was a walk. It was a walk through it, man. I didn't get instantaneous healing. I made bad decisions. I opened the door. And it was just every time it just fired me up. And I just weep and weep over it, knowing that it was something that could not stay in my life because it was keeping me stuck. It was prohibiting the anointing from truly flowing out of my life. It was prohibiting the anointing from growing and maturing in my life. I mean, I still had a realm that I had touched because God's a good God. He doesn't take away our toys when we're bad. You know, when he's given you something, he doesn't just take it away right from you because you made you got a bad attitude, you made a mistake. God doesn't work like that. He gives every man a season. He raises up and he takes down on his time. And we don't know, for each man it's different. Sometimes it's days, sometimes it's weeks, sometimes it's years, sometimes it's the course of their life. You don't know, you don't want to risk it. You want to get it fixed. As soon as it's exposed, fix. So I just kept going the Holy Spirit every time because I knew the emotion was wrong. I knew the attitude, the behavior was wrong. Anything that took me out of the peace like that was wrong. And so it took a while. And then one day I went to this person and I was just, the anointing was there. The conviction was there. The sincerity, the truth was there, you know. And it was like, look at, you know, and even though I felt I was the unjustified, I was abused, I was hurt, I was, you know, you were the wrong, you know what I'm saying? We're always right and everybody else is wrong and woe is me and everyone take care of me. And, saw, I went to this person and I just said, you know, look, it, I just need your forgiveness. I want to get this right. I want this to be, you know, fixed, reconciled, whatever, you know, the words were. And, you know, and the person's reaction wasn't a good reaction. And I started crying. I'm like, God, why'd you make me do that? Why did I feel the conviction when I was just going to get burned again and have to go through this whole cycle again? You know, I was just starting to make headway of feeling peace about the release. And now I've got another mount. I got another reason to add to the mountain, and we're back down in the ditch. We're all the way down, you know. And the Lord just put in my heart, I'm looking at your heart. I'm looking at your response. I'm looking at your attitude and your behavior. I just wept and wept, and I cried out to God, and I said, God, you know, I'll release this, you know. And it was such a breakthrough. And I had heard, you know, you don't need that in your life. Because there's things we don't need in our life. Sometimes there's situations that are just, they're just far past. But so long as we release it and we get our hearts right and we get our responses right, the Lord will come and invade and release it all and take care of it all so that you can continue on in growth. You can continue on in maturity, and nothing will keep you stuck. Nothing will affect you. And praise God when we do get the right responses and the other person's like, yes, I wanted, you know, I wanted to do this. I wanted to have reconciliation. And praise God, you're reconciled, you know. But what matters is your response. Your heart in it. No matter if you think you're right and the other person is wrong, your response needs to go to them and make sure it's right and fixed. So that you are not stuck. You have nothing, no bitterness hindering you from moving forward in the things of God. There's issues you have to go confront to move forward. So we're going to continue on. I really want that to be so resounding in your spirit to just, in every situation of your life, determine that you will not be held captive. Be determined that you will not allow anything to keep you held back or stuck. Do whatever it takes, no matter how low and how humble you have to be, to get it right. Get it right. Do whatever it takes to be able to carry your cross and move forward in this life of Jesus Christ, because on that day, that will be all that matters. The rest of this stuff will just be wood, stubble, and hay. You'll think, with great sorrow, why did I allow that to be keeping me stuck? Why did I allow that inappropriate behavior? Why did I allow that inappropriate response, that inappropriate opinion, that inappropriate emotions to carry on in my spirit? Because God had so much greatness for me, and I was stuck. I was in captive of my own flesh, of my own emotions. I exalted my emotions above God's word. I exalted my opinion above God's word. I exalted the abuse of man, the pain of man, above God's word. Jesus has healing. He has deliverance. He's got the miracle. So long as you're willing to move forward, to go into maturity in the fullness of Jesus Christ. We have to evaluate our lives and make sure we have the field kept, the field clean and producing the seed of God's word. And if we're feeling frustrated, we're feeling stuck, we've got to make sure we go to the cross and say, God, show me. I must move forward in you. I demand maturity in you. And if I'm not seeing fruit, and I'm not seeing growth, and I'm not seeing maturity, my God fix me. My God search me. My God expose me. Take it out. Clean me up, Father. We have to live our lives in full transparency before God and before those that God has anointed in our lives. We must live in this humility, this meekness in the body of Jesus Christ. It's a culture change. It's everything opposite about what your teachers have taught you and what your mom and dad has taught you. The kingdom of heaven culture is very different than your culture, than the society that you've called as being normal and pleasing and comfortable and fine. You got to be asking God, God, show me your kingdom culture. Make me a kingdom person. Make me a Jesus person. Yeah. Father, that you find in me worthy of your kingdom. And by the blood of Jesus Christ, we're made worthy. But when we're not willing to seek after these things, we're not willing to seek after the fullness of God. We're not willing to be faithful to the house of God. Can you really say, well done, I've been faithful? Well done, I've been a good, faithful servant. I've been a good, faithful slave. Nobody likes the word slave. You need to get your slave on. You need to feel the weight of the cross. You look at these different ones. You think that if Jesus had to go all the way to the cross and feel a bloody, torturous, mocking, scourging death, that we have any reason that we're just going to live in this pleasure and easygoing life to have the life of Jesus Christ? I mean, it's abundance blessing, but come on, there's sacrifice. You think if all the disciples of Jesus were brutally martyred, except John, because they tried a bunch of things, but they couldn't do it, so they just exiled him to Patmos, which is Kate and I got to see, which is just nothing. It's just a cave, you know? And we think that our life is supposed to be any easier. We're telling God, oh, give us the mansion, give us the car, give us this, that, and the other thing. He didn't promise that in this life. He promised that in the next life. But then for some reason, we've got the opposite of crazy. And we think we're supposed to be living on pennies and always be poor and barely making it. Only have barely enough for me, only have barely enough for my food and my clothes, and can't ever give in any sacrificial way. We've got the opposite extremes. Broad is the way to destruction, and very, very narrow and strict is the way to the kingdom of heaven. God wants to give us the abundant life. More than just the eternal life. He wants to give us the blessings, the goodness of his pleasure. And oh, is there glory. Oh, is there wonder. Oh, is there benefits and blessing. But oh, is there sacrifice and discomfort. Yeah, that's right. Have you felt your cross lately? Have you felt the weight of the cross lately? Have you done anything for the kingdom of God that's been inconvenient or uncomfortable for you? I mean, we're asking people to pass out flyers, and it's like pulling teeth out of a chicken. I'm making it mandatory. Every house, every family has to pass out 50 flyers in your own neighborhood, and you should also come to the outreaches that we're doing here for the local neighborhoods. In addition, if you have social media, be posting the Pat Schatzline flyer on your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, whatever sources that you have, your bulletin, your senior bingo club, wherever it is. Be posting. Be participating. Ask your outside friends, hey, do you mind posting this to your wall? Facebook wall, if anybody's not understanding what wall I meant. You know? And that's like such a burden. How dare we demand something at the local church? I mean, my God, what's wrong with us thinking that the people should serve in the house of God? If you're not going to serve God and you're going to come to this church, you're going to serve the local church. And by the mercy and grace of God, through serving in the local church, your motives, your things, your issues are going to get sorted out so you can start serving God. Or else you're just getting in the way and go ahead down to the street next door because they don't mind. There's no demand. They've got staff. They can take care of it themselves. But I'm looking for kingdom people, people that want to serve as an army for the kingdom of God. I'm looking for people who want to be slaves to the kingdom of God, people that have no problem with discomfort, people that have no problem with inconvenience, because you recognize anything to do with the house of God, the service of God, is first priority, and the rest has to shift down the line. We got our priorities all wrong. And yet we say we're seeking first the kingdom of God. It's crazy. It's not measurable. It's not provable. You can't write it down. You can't put it on a piece of paper and show me, where are you doing it? What are you doing? Give me concrete reasons. So many times you sort through people's issues. So, okay, well, what exactly was said? What exactly happened? Well, I just felt it, you know? Or was something very minuscule that was said that got blown up into 1,000 fantasies? Go join creation at Disney because you've got a wild mind, you know? And so once you actually had to put concrete down of what actually happened, you realize that it was just a demonic spirit that was brought into that conversation or that issue, and it really never actually happened. People create hell and wonder, why do I have hell? Stop living in hell. Stop acting like hell and you won't have hell. So I'm going to go to my third point. Okay? I know we've got some tangents, but I think it's for somebody here this morning. I think the Holy Spirit's speaking to somebody here this morning. Amen. So verse 14 is my third point. And the one falling in the thorn bushes, these are the ones hearing, but under cares and riches and pleasures of life, moving along, they're choked and they do not bear maturity. We all know what cares, riches, and pleasures spell. I don't have to say it. Satan thinks if he can't do something internal, if he can't get in your mind, if he can't get in your heart, then he's going to do something external. From keeping you from moving forward in Jesus. And I like to look at it as the thorns being distractions. The thorns of distractions. Satan wants to keep you hopelessly immature in the things of God. We don't have children doing a task, you know, a hard work that we really need to rely on for a serious job. We don't give that to children. That makes sense, right? We wait until they're mature. We let them assist us, some of us, you know, kind of going along with us, seeing how we're doing it, but we're doing the work because we've matured to be able to do that work. Just because time's going by does not ensure maturity. We can have 50-year-olds in the house that still act like 5-year-olds. And the majority of the church walks around like the nursery in diapers, constantly pulling each other's hair, biting each other, having an issue with, you know, about every little thing. My toy this, my toy that. He got money and I didn't. He got that job and I didn't. Her clothes were cooler than mine. Their house was better. Why did they get that? Why did their spouse turn out way better than mine? I don't know, just these thorns of distraction. these immaturities that Satan plays as a game, and you're dancing to that tune from one distraction to the next of issue. Amen. So three distractions that are pointed out here, okay, is pretty clear, but I just want to break them down. So we got three distractions that keep you from maturing, okay? We've got cares. So cares is worry, anxiety, stress, fear, all these cares. Worry will keep you from maturing in the Lord. With some people, that they truly believe that like these problems, someone's personality. You know, it's a disease, it's an illness, or it's just how they are. It's just who they are. So we excuse them as that being acceptable and that being okay. So we just kind of turn a blind eye and give a wink. You know, don't put too much on them. You know what I'm saying? We learn each other's personality, and that's how we just, oh yeah, that's why. You have to understand, you have to change. I mean, some people that I was dealing with, they're really prone to stress very easily, you know. We've got names for it. We've got illnesses. We've got diseases. We've got, you know, all of our different personality breakdowns that we have, your INJF, your EJF, in, you know, all the different things that we have, our classifications. We've all got our little boxes of where we fit in, you know, and why we make certain decisions and how, why we respond to things, because that's just your personality. That's the cards you've been dealt, so to speak. You know, and I was telling this person, I was just like, look, it does not matter. God does not call you to stress. And if you live in this realm of easy stress, or you know, some people just easy emotional, just very emotional, everything. It doesn't matter if they're in business, they're in family. It's all so emotional. You know, they can't ever separate that personal emotion that's there. And I was telling this person, I was like, you can never really be used in great. You can never really be used great in God if you allow simple things like this to distract you, to inhibit you. How on earth can you go and say that you're called to the mission field and be one of those people that if you don't get a shower every day and you don't get a bite to eat every 2 hours, that you're going to make it out there, because it's not always going to work out. And if that's what stresses you out and sets you off, you're your own worst enemy. You know, you have to start saying, God, stretch me. What are the areas of my high maintenance, of my frailties, of my issues that keep me cared in cares and worries and anxieties and stresses, so that I can start fixing them now, Lord, so that I truly can go wherever you have called me to go, that I truly can speak whatever you've called me to speak. If you're constantly fearful for your life, you'll never be able to speak in the name of Jesus in a third world country, because you're constantly on the run. I mean, Americans, we stick out like a sore thumb wherever we would go. In Nepal, Africa, it was just, oh, you got a major crowd just by being white in there, you know? It's like, it was awesome. We just walk around and wait for the crowd to build. Okay, now we're going to preach a message. And then you've got some people that coming, it was, you know, coming after you, and you have occasional times you've got to be ready to run for your life. But if you stress easy, or you're just emotional and fearful, you're going to freak out, panic, and you're not going to make it very long. So the Lord's not going to send you there. He can't send you there yet. You're not responsible enough. You're not ready. So you've got to be evaluating these things now, saying, okay, where am I limiting you, God? Where am I limiting you, God, so that you can expose this to me, to start stretching me, to start preparing now? Failure to prepare is preparing to fail. If if you don't start preparing in the areas that you can clearly see, yeah, I care about things I shouldn't care about. I worry, I stress, I'm fearful over things that I shouldn't be doing that over. You've got to give that to the Lord and say, God, stretch me. And hope and pray to goodness that he's going to start throwing some fireballs at you of circumstance so that you can start being tried through the fire and come out untouched. Like, yes, I came out. God, you're stretching me. I know this is what you're doing for me because you're preparing me to be a good soldier, to go wherever you want me to go, to say whatever you want me to say, to not be distracted in these thorns. So my next point I want to stay on that a little bit. I don't feel like I got it all the way out. If you have worries, you've got those anxieties, you need to smile more. You need to stop coming in the house. Leave your baggage at the door and then don't pick it up. Even if you don't feel like smiling, put on your weird, scary smile and cry out to God in truth and sincerity so that it becomes real. Because here, if we're just saying, God, give me joy, God, give me joy, God, give me joy, God, give me joy, but we're never engaged in it, we're never actively participating in it, why? Why should he? We're just vain repetitions now. You know, I had some kids in youth. For way too long, give me boldness, God. Give me boldness, God. Give me boldness. And so finally I was just, it was a great prayer. We need boldness. And after too much time went by, I said, hold up. You can't pray that anymore. How have you been actively engaging in boldness? How have you been stepping out in faith that God's given you boldness? Well, that's why you haven't received boldness. You have to actively participate. You have to actively engage. And as you step out in faith and you do it, the miracle will come. It will be there. The supply will be there as you rely on the Holy Spirit for it. So I'm making that point with your smile. Come on, call out to God for joy as you actively participate in it. Come dancing before the Lord, thankful before the Lord, even if you've got all hell coming against you, all the hordes of hell out to get you, which is probably just yourself because nobody's doing nothing enough to really have the hordes of hell coming out against them. And if you're taking nations and all sorts of things, then we can understand, my God. But the rest is mostly just you that you've given the devil way too much credit. And the devil's like, well, okay, sure. I didn't do that. Did you guys do that? Sure, yes, go ahead and glorify me a little more of something I didn't do. That was yourself. But moving forward, to being focused on the kingdom of God, being focused on living the life of Jesus Christ, being focused on more than just eternal life, but abundant life in Jesus' name. So my next point is riches. Just always got to have more money. Always getting caught up with the money. Always getting caught up in, just the house, the car. Oh no, the government. The finances, the family. We're just caught up in these just distractions. The riches, our family, our finances, the government, and we're so bogged down in that. Our mind is so captivated on that. We're so captivated on the provision for our family. We're so captivated on the house, the gas money. I'm just going to make the announcement now. Don't come tell me you don't have gas money for youth. Don't tell me. I'm the last person you want to tell. you brood of vipers, you faithless generation. Go get prayer. But don't tell me, because I have no sympathy for it. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry. I don't have sympathy for that. If you have gas money for your job and you don't have gas money to make it to the things of the kingdom, I pray you don't have gas money for your job anymore. Moving forward. You're always feeling unfulfilled because of things you think that you should have. The money's so important. The money's such a big deal. The job is such a big deal. The identity in that job is such a big deal. You got to strip that identity out and really ask the Lord, Father, how much identity do I have in you, and how much identity do I have in my money? How much identity do I have in you, Jesus, and how much identity do I have in the car that I drive, the house that I have? Because until you're willing to allow it to be completely stripped from you, a lot of times you're too numb and insensitive to the Spirit that you don't realize 99% of your identity is in your money and in your house and in your car, and barely 1% is in Jesus. And if you're not willing to lay it all on the altar and at least make some inconveniences, so to speak, to serve in the house of God, to be rude and call it an inconvenience, then you don't have your identity fully in Jesus Christ, and you need to change. Come on, let's be sober here. Let's evaluate. Let's measure. The last one is pleasures. If Satan can't get you to stop serving God, he's going to keep pushing you in each different direction. There's always going to be something else that you've got to take care of. There's always going to be something else that you've got to do. Satan's a master of his craft. If he can't keep you from serving God, then he's going to keep you distracted with one thing and the other. Constantly pushing, oh, but we have to get this done. But we have to do this now. But we have to be here. There's always this urgency on your other stuff when it comes to doing something in the kingdom of God. When somebody asks you to serve, you're immediately thinking, how can I say no, rather than and looking for an excuse. I mean, humans, we're incredible at laziness. We are incredible at making excuses for why we cannot. We're masters at it. Where your mind immediately goes like that rather than saying, no, I can set everything else aside. Okay, how can I do this? This is how it's going to work. This is how I can say yes rather than this is how I, what is it? What is it? I know there's something so that I can say no, you know? Am I being a little too truthful? Is that why we're so quiet? So pleasures, you know how there's just some people, they just live for pleasures, you know? They're going from like one vacation to the next vacation, and, you know, they're different pursuits or they're different hobbies. And they just become obsessed, you know, with certain things. And to a degree, they're a frustrated field when it comes to the kingdom of God. I mean, there's some people in this place. You ask them about the things of God, and it's like, it's very superficial, it's very shallow, but then you start asking them about guns or some one of their hobbies. Gosh, they can talk for hours and hours and hours and just keep going down the whole analytical process of it all, pretty much, you know? So we see where you've been studying. Let's go ahead and take a shift and move that to the Word so that instead we can talk about the Word and things of God for hours and hours. And the rest is just kind of, you know, I'm not saying your hobbies are wrong. I'm not saying your vacations are wrong. I very, 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 very much believe in family vacations and taking time together and those kinds of things. So I'm not saying these things are wrong. But when there's such an obsession that they're captivating your heart to where you can so much it's so easy for you to talk about your hobbies, your vacations, and those kinds of things. But when you're going to talk about the Word of God and you're going to talk about Jesus Christ and allowing a wellspring to come up, it's just barely this like, you know what I'm saying? Just these pleasures, people that just live, they live for pleasures. How can you be faithful in the local church when you're just living for pleasures? You're just living for that next football game. Come on. I know there's some of those in here are, what are you guys called, the fantasy football guys? You won't stay late in church, but you'll be staying late so you can meet up with the guys and go through all your rankings and whatever it is that's going on. You're checking the score during service. And you wonder why you're out of order. You wonder why things just aren't happening. You're dishonoring the house of God. Oh, but I stayed in the service. I just checked it really quick on my phone. You're dishonoring the house of God. And Facebook is no different. Don't get on Facebook when you're in the house of God. You wonder why you're out of order. You wonder why your kids aren't serving in the church or even in this church. You wonder why your finances or your marriage just is not the heavenly blessings, the days of heaven on earth. Well, look at the areas that are out of order. It's simple things, people. We act like we've got to go strip in the church and do something wild to be out of order. No. Is any of these distractions constantly looking around the room, you know, evaluating the back of the heads, all of these things, they're dishonors in the house of God. Constantly going to the bathroom. I mean, in youth, we have a 60-second rule. If you got to go to the bathroom and it's really bad, you got 60 seconds and we're timing you. My God, we need to make that a rule in this house. I don't know if it's just Sunday you choose to drink a gallon before service or what's happening. Everybody's pregnant with a baby dancing on their bladder is what I'm assuming. Anyways, sorry, we'll move forward. Excuse my... You never mature in the Lord running after other things. Instead of keeping the kingdom of God first. In Matthew 6:33, he says, seek first the kingdom of God, not all the other things. We're seeking all the other things and adding God onto the list. And we look, Jesus says, in comparison, you got to hate everything else. You got to hate your mama, your daddy, your brothers, your sisters, the people that are, you know, where a lot of your identity and self-worth can come from, that family bond that you have, mom and dad, brothers and sisters, especially when you're looking at how God views family. God views family with just such unity, such love, so much fun. I mean, when we get together as a family, it's ridiculously stupid how much fun it is to get together with them. We just love each other so much because that was something that my dad was determined to keep in the house, was Holy Ghost love in the family. And so you look at Jesus, who understands what family means, not what necessarily your family means, because I don't know what that is for some of you, but for what Jesus is talking about, a heavenly love, bond, fun, he's saying, you gotta hate it all in comparison to me. Seeking first the kingdom of God, you've got to hate it all in comparison. But just add it to the list. It's just another casual task. When it works out, it works out. We can't have that mentality. We've got to ask the Holy Spirit, Father, your cross, just come and plow up all these areas of dead religion that I have allowed in my life, of compromise that I've allowed in my life, of wrong emotions, of wrong behaviors in my life. We're running after riches. We're running after the career. We're running after the job. There's nothing wrong with the job so long as it's in its proper place. There's nothing wrong with the money so long as it's in its proper place. And I'd really try to communicate this. If you don't have helicopters and boats and you're making billions of dollars and that's all going into the kingdom, it is absolutely insanity to think that your job is an excuse. Or your job is a viable reason to be a distraction. That you're actually contributing something. That would be a reason for why you couldn't serve more or why you couldn't go. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's just nonsense. The pennies that we scrape and we're saying, wow, we're really doing a lot. This is why I've got to keep this job and I can't go for the Lord. You know what I'm saying? Good. Thank you, Jesus. When you keep God's house in order, everything else comes into line. And if you know you've had issues that have happened in the past and the repercussions were losing family members, I petition you. Get serious with God. Cry out to God. Bring them continually before the Father, calling them into the kingdom of God. Let it stir your emotions deeply. And as far as I'm concerned, if they've left this church to go to another church, they're under a rebellious spirit. And just as if they were unsaved, you need to be crying out to God with deep, passionate emotions to the Father and petitioning the Father for that to come into line, to come into order. Our family should move us deeply in terms of seeing them make the kingdom of God. Not that we're going to walk around all bogged down and depressed and not living in the fullness of God, you know? But when you're in your secret time with the Lord, that should be an intense cry of the heart. That should be an emotional thing that's going on with you and the Father. I think that was for somebody. All right, so we're going to continue on. Chapter 8, verse 15. And the one in the good earth, these are the ones who in right and good heart, hearing the word, they hold it and bear fruit in patience. Come on. Can I get an amen? That was a good thing. I'll read it again. I think somebody didn't hear it. I think everybody was still trying to figure out the last point that I said and was really feeling the sobriety. And the one in the good earth, these are the ones who in the right and good heart, hearing the word, they hold it and bear fruit in patience. I prophesy, I command every person to be this, to hear the word, to hold it and bear fruit in patience. Because now we know, okay, these are the distractions, these are the thorns, these are the cares, the riches and pleasures, these are the areas that we've kept, that's kept us stuck, that's kept us from living in the kingdom. Now we break them in Jesus' name. Father, we bring them to the cross. We allow you to plow this up in Jesus' name. And now we're going to hear the word, we're going to hold to it, and we're going to bear fruit. You have to understand, in this kind of walk, it's you have to be honest. You do not let your mind deceive you that you are exempt from this message. We're to be good-hearted people. We're to be a generous people. We're to be full of love with no bitterness, with no jealousy, with no comparison, but full of compassion. To cling to the word, it produces a huge harvest, an abundant harvest. A huge harvest does not come quickly. You have to have patience. patience over the word of God and over the seeds of God and what you're preparing and seeking and participating and actively engaging in. You have to have patience with the harvest. And there has to be faithfulness with the harvest. Anybody that does trees, anybody that does any kind of gardening or fruit, you understand. You don't just get it immediately because you put the seed in and boom, it happens. And when we're going for perfect fruit, we're going for the mature things. That takes time. That takes patience. That takes faithfulness. That takes a continual brooding and hovering and watching over it. You have to plant, you have to weed, and you have to wait. And by wait, you know what I'm saying, what I just said, where we're actively engaged in participating in this kingdom life with Jesus Christ. We're engaged in this abundant life and having it in our house, in our temples, in our bodies, everything about us being an excellent representation of Jesus Christ. I mean, we got too much fast food. We act like God's Taco Bell. We sit on our, you know, we sit on our in our car or comfortable seat. Okay, Lord, this is my order. Bring me a soda on your way down. And it's supposed to just happen. And then we get all discouraged about it. Oh, wow, we did it for 6 months. Somewhat faithfully. Why didn't we have increase? Why didn't I have a promotion? You're crazy. God has his perfect time on everything. How long are you willing to be faithful with it? How long are you willing to be in expectation with it? How long are you willing to be watering it continually with perfect patience, with intense and active faith? Come on, I'm talking about an abundant life, having an abundant life. The devil, he comes to kill and to kill, to steal, to destroy. Everything the devil has, everything the devil does is because we've given him permission. You can't blame the devil. You look at it. You go back up on the verses and you look. If the footpaths weren't there, the birds wouldn't have been able to grab the seed. The birds couldn't have grabbed up the word of God. That was the opportunity that was given to Satan to steal the word from us, to steal the truth from us. If we would have been willing to plow it all up, say, God, your word is my reality. Come on, authority, bring down the correction. Bring down the fire. Bring down the change. I'll make whatever adjustments. I don't care if it's from the deepest part of my spirit or the shoes on my feet. It doesn't matter how superficial or how deep. Father, give it to me and I'll do it. I'll change it. I'll fix it. I'll adjust it. But when we're not willing to do that, then we gave Satan permission, an area where he could come steal something from us. Temptation. You fail. If you fail in temptation, you don't know why. Why did I fail, you know, in temptation? Because you have rocks in your heart and you haven't allowed the power of the word to come and take hold of you. Because the power of the word can overcome every temptation. Every stronghold, the power of the word, when we allow it to take root in our lives, where it's truly not just what we say we believe, but it is what we live, there is nothing that can overcome. You look at Jesus when he's tempted, he just had Deuteronomy. Just Deuteronomy. I mean, for me, that's kind of boring. One of the boring chapters that I just try to kind of get through. Way rather be in, you know, the prophets or the New Testament, just to be a little honest here. I'm still maturing. I'm still working on the revelation in there. Oh, Jesus had Deuteronomy, and it was so taken root in him. I mean, he was the Word. He is the Word. The Word had so taken hold of him. That all of Satan's tricks was completely eradicated just by the spoken word. And he's given us that. When the word takes root, when it takes deep hold, there's no rocks blocking it. There's nothing you can't overcome. Whatever you're facing, whatever circumstance, or whatever situation, the victory is there in Jesus so long as you take hold of it, so long as you allow it to have deep root, so long as you allow it to take full control in your spirit, the victory is there in every single situation, every miracle, everything. The victory is there. And if you're not receiving it, let God evaluate you. Get on your face before God and say, God, search me, know me, try my ways. See if there be any wicked thing. See if there be any rocks. See if there be any footpaths that don't belong. See if there be any of these distractions, these thorns, these cares, these riches, these pleasures. And Father, if it's there, I repent of it right now and I renounce it. Because Father, your abundant life, this life of you, Lord Jesus, is all that I'm living for. It's all that truly matters to me. Too many people that grew up in the church singing, God, you can have my all. God, you're all I'm living for. They didn't mean it. So it became something that was religious to them. And essentially seared their spirit so that they can live out their own life and say that they're living for God. And he's all they're living for. And it's nothing but just a lie. It's nothing but just a deception that's kept you blinded, that seared your spirit to not move you to feel the convicting power of the Holy Spirit. To say, that's not truth in the inward parts. This needs to become truth in your inward parts. The Holy Spirit is here right now, moving, bringing conviction, exposing things this morning. If there's things that you need to repent of, this is the morning to do it. If there's things that you need to renounce, this is the morning to do it. I want this to be the day that you can truly, from the depths of your being, in honesty and sincerity, say, we will forget what's behind and we will press forward. That we're not just going for our life, but we're going for the 30, the 60, and the 100-fold is what we're living for in the abundance of abundant life. If Satan cannot keep you from eternal life, he's going to do everything he can to keep you from abundant life. Hence, the church has been so ineffective. When we start pressing in for the abundant life, we will be an unstoppable force for the kingdom of God. You must decide today, I'm going to live for eternity. I must live for the fullness of the life of Jesus. I must live to be a sacrifice. I must live for the abundant life. I must live for the highest rewards. I must live for Jesus in all that he's called me to. For these works and greater, as you said, Lord Jesus. This is not a time for comfort and ease. This is a time for blood. This is a time for sweat. And this is a time for tears before God. If the Holy Spirit can't touch your emotions so deep to where at the slightest move, it can just bring you to sobbing tears. Or it can bring you to ecstatic joy. I say you're lukewarm and insensitive, and you need to repent and allow God to once again have place in your life. Maybe you've never even had the opportunity of truly giving your emotions over to God, truly giving your life over to Jesus. Today is your day to live for the emotional life, the abundant life. It's a spiritual emotions. It takes deep, deep root on the inside. You feel it deep within your being. If the Holy Spirit at any time can't touch you deep, 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 you want that to be an alarm to you that says, I've become lukewarm. Holy Spirit, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry for being insensitive to you. I'm so sorry for rejecting you. Because I know that you, the way that you move, the way that you've purposed, the way that you've planned for my life is such an intimate and deep fellowship and relationship. If you could get a glimpse of heaven, if you could get a true glimpse of heaven, you would never backslide again. Everything about the way that you're living today would change. Eternity would mean so much more. Living fully sold out for the kingdom would mean so much more. It would drive you to tears just thinking of the urgency. Everybody wants to think that a backslidden state is just, you know, all the big sins so that we deem as big, but it's all equal. The adultery, it's no different than the gossip. The murder, it's no different than the strife and the dissension. It's all creating a backslidden state for you. You can't act like one's not that bad of a sin and the other one, oh, you would never participate, you would never do, you know. Any of these areas that we're giving place to the devil, he will come in like a flood. He will come in to block this abundant life and keeping you stuck. Understand, if you could just get a glimpse of heaven, everything about your life would change. Everything about the way that you're living, your eternity, would change. And I just ask the Holy Spirit to just come right now and breathe. You have to understand, it was your sin that put Jesus on the cross. It was your religion that you have right now in this place that beat him, that scourged him, that mocks him, that rejects him. We want to act like that's in the past and that was for the Pharisees and the Jews. When we live our lives right now with that kind of religion, continuing to beat Jesus afresh. Because that's what your religion does. It's a mockery to Jesus. It's a mockery to the cross. It's a false representation. It's got to become so important to us that we do not ignore the Holy Spirit, that we no longer reject him. In every one of our behaviors, in every one of our emotions, in every one of our decisions should completely be given over to the Holy Spirit to come. Holy Spirit, what do you think about this? Holy Spirit, is this a behavior? Is this emotion? Is this from you? Father, am I walking in this glory that you've had purpose? Was this what you planned for me to do today? Where we truly link with the Spirit and live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit, continually acknowledging the Spirit of God in us. That we do not forsake this so great a salvation. You have to start seeing yourself as a supernatural person that's living for the life of Jesus, that's living for the joy, that's living for the peace, that's living for the authority, that's living for Jesus Christ. You have to see yourself every day as that supernatural person. If you're seeing yourself as less, you are allowing the thorns of distraction. You're allowing rocks. You're allowing dead works inside of you to take hold, to keep you back, to disqualify yourself. When we're not willing to live out this life of Jesus Christ and we're exalting our job, we're exalting our circumstance, we're exalting our problems, we're exalting our bad attitude, you're saying, Jesus, your blood wasn't good enough for me. Your blood didn't have the finished work for me. There's not all power and authority in your blood when you do that, when you're willing to exalt your job, your problems, your issues. When you come dragging that in and you're not willing to release it and let it go. If you have to bring it in, you better make sure you're the only reason why it's still with you is because you're coming to lay it at the altar. You're coming to look on those leaders, so to speak. Because you just have to have that extra prayer. Because your faith just hasn't gotten to the place yet that you recognize that Jesus is on the inside to give you every single cure. It's a serious mistake to come into the house of God without expectation. To settle with coming in with our problems and being okay with leaving with our problems, with our sin, with our bad attitude, with our wrong behaviors, with your religion. Because pastor can clean up your house all day. He can drive out the spirit all day. But if you're not willing to have resolve in your will to say, Jesus, only you are allowed in here. And these problems cannot have any more hold. This religion cannot have any more hold. Then you're opening up your spirit to far worse spirits. You're opening yourself to a seared conscience against the Holy Spirit. An insensitivity that you're openly allowing against Him to move on you. It's time for the church to once again feel the emotions of God. Feel the depth of His heart. Feel the conviction that the Holy Spirit brings so that we can move on in glory to glory to glory. So that we can just not just live for eternity, the eternal life, but we can live for the abundant life in Jesus. Father, that there no longer be allowed anyone in this person that's willing to just settle with mediocrity. that God's love can once again truly fill His house. That His overwhelming love can truly come and move upon every heart. That it can truly be manifested in such a real and living and critical and sovereign way in His house. That can't happen until we allow God to touch us so deep. That can't happen until we're willing to put it all on the altar. Truly all on the altar. Truly our heart on the all on the altar. That it's more than just words, but it's how that we live. Father, I thank You that any fields of frustration here, any fields that are a wreck here, Father, that every field in here becomes a place of glorifying You, God, in everything that we do. Father, that the words that we speak, that our behaviors, that our emotions, that our actions, everything that we step our foot on, that we put our hands to, that we put our mind to, Father, that it glorify You, that it glorify Your kingdom. The only reason that you're stuck is because you've allowed yourself to be stuck. The only reason why the devil has been given any place in your life or in your family is because you have allowed it. And I ask You, remove the rocks. Remove the thorns. Remove the distractions. Let the cross plow up the footpaths. Let everything about our lives, God, be to glorify You. Let everything about our business, let everything about our relationships, let everything about every dimension of our life, God, be to truly glorify You, truly for living in Your kingdom and demonstrating Your kingdom here on earth, oh God. Father, whatever the sacrifice, we bring it to You today, whatever it is, oh God. The Holy Spirit is moving on people's hearts. Right now, just let the Holy Spirit move on your heart. There's not one person that shouldn't feel the Holy Spirit moving on your heart. So if you don't feel the Holy Spirit moving on your heart, just start saying, Father, I'm sorry. Father, I want to get this right. Father, I want to feel You deep on the inside. Oh God, I just want to know You. I just want to know You for who You are. I just want to be everything You've intended me to be, every intricate detail that You've planned. Father, I don't want to miss out. Make my life truly count for Your kingdom. Father, no matter what it is, I put it on the altar. I know we're going late. And if you have to go, you can go, just know you're not walking out of a meeting, but you're walking out on the Holy Spirit moving. Oh, Jesus, 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 Father. Oh, Father, this people here. Father, you see every need. You see every heart. You see every circumstance right now, Father. And I just ask you to come and intervene in your mercy and your grace to take full control. Take full control. Take full control. I break every religious thing here. I bind your power in Jesus' name. Father, you said that we could have these works and greater. And this religious thing is a greater works to be broken. So right now it's broken in Jesus' name. I command every spirit to come into alignment. I command you to take on the life of Jesus Christ. I command you to take on the blessing. I command you to take on the benefit. I command you to take on the will of Jesus Christ for the Father to be sovereign in your life. Holy Spirit, take full control of every person. Holy Spirit, come take hold. You can all stand. Just lift your hands. Give God your heart. Some of you just got to erase the chalkboard. You just got to erase all the things that you think you know about the Word and your opinions and your experience. I don't care if you're in this place and you've won 1 million people to Jesus and you've done this, that, and the other thing, or you're a person that's never even come to know Jesus yet. This is a time to just yield to the Holy Spirit, a time to give Him your affections and your heart. Say, God, use me more. Stay reverential. Stay reverential. This is a critical time right now. Reverence God. Reverence the Holy Spirit. Don't be talking. Don't be moving around. Don't be checking your phone. Don't be worrying about your stomachs or your bladders. This is a critical time. Just let the Holy Spirit work with you right where you're at. Let the Holy Spirit deal with you right where you're at. Let the Holy Spirit flood your life right where you're at. He's come to touch you individually right where you're at. Jesus, 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 we give it all to you right now, God. Change us, fix us, break us. mold us, shape us. Oh, Father. Oh. That we be instruments for your kingdom, that we be good soldiers, that we be excellent representations of you, Jesus, and nothing less and nothing short. If there's anyone here that needs to, has never given their life to Jesus or needs to rededicate their life, you can come forward. But other than that, I want you to just let the Holy Spirit come brood over you. I want the Holy Spirit to just come work in your heart. The Holy Spirit come touch you. So if you need Jesus, you've never accepted him into your life, or you need to renounce and repent of some things, you can come forward. We'll just see what the Holy Spirit does. If not, just wait on the Holy Spirit just a little longer. Just a little longer. Ooh, Jesus. When we allow God to just come and touch us deep right where we're at, the Holy Spirit can impart more than any man can. So just let the Holy Spirit deal with you. Just let the Holy Spirit impart into you. If you're sick in your body, we'll pray for you. Just know as you come up here, the Son truly lives in you. You better be coming up with great expectation that it's done. Stay reverential. If you've got to slip out, just stay reverential. Move very quietly and slowly.